welcome into episode 10 of Game 7. It is Monday, April 11th. Am I off there? No, I'm April 11th. What
April
is today's
11th.
Date, man?
April 8th, dude.
I don't know.
You're off by like 3 days.
Yeah, I don't know what day it is. Welcome into Game 7. We're in Denver, Colorado. Episode 10. What we got going on today, Isaac?
Today, we have a few topics that we want to talk about. We want to talk about the Rockies' bad start, a couple NCAA predictions for the game tonight, some Nuggets playoff scenarios, and I believe that is about it. We have a very short episode today coming to you here, but we do have some very important stuff. Contact us at game7show@gmail.com. Follow us on Facebook at game7show, Twitter at _game7, at Will Satler, and myself at Isaac_Bugarin. Thank you guys for tuning in. You can listen to us live when we go to mymantmedia.com/listen. And press the play button. We are live Mondays from around 2 p.m. to 3 p.m. Today's a shorter episode, so we won't be live till 3 p.m. If you missed our last episode, what did we talk about? I believe it was all about the NCAA,
a little bit
of March Madness, Final Four.
Yeah.
It was opening week, so that's pretty much what we talked about.
Talked about Zion, too. You know, hot takes out there, you know.
Yeah, our Twitter's been blowing up about a horrible sports take that Will said. Bless his heart.
Oh, well.
Bless your heart.
You know, it's all good.
Okay, so the Rockies have gotten off to a tremendously horrible start.
Tremendously horrible. That's a
tremendously
new one.
Horrible. I don't even know if that's the right way to put it, but it has been absolutely hard to watch.
For sure. And just every facet. I mean, we can't say every facet because David Dahl's been good so far.
And he's hurt.
We'll get into that. The top of the rotation has been good. The back of the rotation hasn't had, or the back of the bullpen really hasn't had any time to play
because
they haven't been in games.
Game. Yeah.
So you can't really say they're good or bad, but definitely, you know, a tough
Ian
start
Desmond,
to the season.
Ian Desmond is hitting .084. Is it time to move on? Please say yes. Please say it's time to move on.
No, I'm 100% with you. I said this last night. It's like this experiment has gone on for 2 years. He's tried first. He's tried center. He's tried all over the field when there's been injuries. He's great in the clubhouse from what I've heard. But he's hitting .084. Like, this experiment is not working.
He is statistically the second worst baseball player to play behind Chris Davis of the Orioles.
And he's bad.
And he's a guy that struck out like 27 times this year. But Ian Desmond is a very, very close second. He's hitting .084. You're telling me a center fielder for the Rockies is very bad defensively, very bad offensively, and he's still in the clubhouse? Or he's still getting starting lineups, minutes, or in the rotation? Sorry, I'm sitting here looking at basketball. And Nolan Arenado still doesn't have a home run. I mean, we're almost, what, 2 weeks into the year, a week and a half into the year, and he doesn't have a home run. We're paying this guy $32.5 million. Are you telling me that, like, are there some eyebrows being raised in that clubhouse yet?
Yeah, 100%. And my solution, because now you look to solutions, right? My solution might not work right away, because you would think we could move Garrett Hampson out into the outfield. He could play center, keep Dahl in left, keep Charlie in right, although he looked very bad last night in right field with two errors. But Hampson goes to center, and then McMahon becomes the second baseman. And then if McMahon is hurt, then there comes the argument, well, is Brendan Rodgers ready to play, and can he play second base? So
to kind of bounce off of that, I don't think Brendan Rodgers is ready to play, so I think you'll see Josh Fuentes bounce around in the infield for a while.
Who looked really good in his first debut?
Nolan Arenado's cousin.
Yeah. Hopefully he's successful. That was a pretty cool story to see him get called up on Friday.
And get a hit in his first at-bat Saturday.
Saturday, yeah.
But personally, I think you might see a shift where you see Charlie Blackman move to left field, and you'll see David Dahl, if he can stay healthy, move to right field. And then you could potentially have Tapia play right field also, depending on if Dahl is hurt.
Well, right field and Coors Field is a lot harder to play than left field, just because of the scoreboard and other dimensions down there. But
that's why I think David Dahl's better.
Yeah.
He's faster than Charlie Blackman. I think he has a better arm than Charlie Blackman. He reads the ball a lot better than Charlie Blackman. And I think that you saw it evident in the last week, or in the last month, in September, last season. You saw him track down balls, play center field really well, and also hit the ball really well when Charlie Blackman wasn't playing. But you also see it last night, where you see Charlie Blackman lose a ball in right field, whether it's in the LED lights or whether he just absolutely misplayed it, or the national television attention kind of got in his head, or got in the Rockies' heads, I guess.
Right, right. Yeah. And to move on from the outfield, you go to third base. Nolan Arenado just signed that huge contract, still without a home run. That's a weird stat to focus on, but he led the league last year. He had great at-bats last night. He had the triple. He had another hit later in the game. I think he's going to break out tonight versus the Braves.
I hope so. I really do hope so.
Yep, and he could break out and start playing like Dahl was playing. That was awesome. Dahl was having an all-star caliber year to start the year. He did hurt an oblique, hopefully. Those are usually pretty serious. It's scary, but hopefully he comes back 100%. Hopefully sometime this week, right?
Hopefully.
Sure. And the back end of the rotation. So Freeland and Marquez looked pretty good in their first two starts. They look good, but
I wouldn't say Freeland looked good in his second start in Tampa Bay. He struggled in that one. But Marquez looked pretty good.
Yeah, I mean, they both look good enough to win games, but Tyler Anderson and Chad Bettis in the back end of that bullpen just look horrible.
So the Rockies are 4-7. What's next? Are we overreacting to this bad start, or what is going on?
I've been on such a roller coaster. At first, I was like, no, we're overreacting. They just got off to such a good start in years past, and now it feels like they're horrible. And then after this weekend series with the Dodgers, like, this is just like, I can't watch this anymore. Like, it's... they need to make big changes, and I still believe that they may need to make big changes, but I think we are overreacting. They're 4-7. They could sweep the Braves here and be at 500.
Yeah.
So, yes, we're overreacting, and they're going to hit. I know we say that the last 2 years, but they're going to hit.
I don't think they hit. This lineup struggles. Predictions for tonight's NCAA championship game. What do you got?
Virginia and Texas Tech playing tonight. Ty Jerome, Kyle Guy for Virginia needs to be big. Virginia just snuck by Auburn, so I have Virginia 72, Texas Tech 69, and Kyle Guy is the most valuable player. That's a senior. That's a leader.
I take Virginia, but I think it's going to be a lot lower game. I think it's going to be probably more like 62-59. I think that because, well, Virginia has never played Texas Tech before. This is the first time they've ever played against each other.
Wow.
Virginia ranks first in the country in scoring defense and is the only school in the nation to average fewer than 9 turnovers a game.
It's pretty good.
Virginia's 28-0 this season when leading at the half and 32-0 when holding opponents less than 50% shooting from the field. So I'm pretty sure this Virginia defense is going to be pretty rock solid tonight, and I think it's going to be a very low scoring game. So that's why I say 62-59. You won't see a very high scoring game or a very offensive explosion game. It's going to be very low scoring. It's going to be a dog battle. It's going to be a fight.
Looking for a good game, man. That's all I can hope for, right?
100%.
Yeah.
Nuggets playoff scenarios. What do we got? The Warriors have clinched the number one seed. The Nuggets hold a half-game lead over Houston, right?
Mm-hmm.
Which is kind of scary considering that we just blew the game last night to Portland on purpose.
Yeah.
Which is very interesting. So the Nuggets need to win out against the Jazz and the Timberwolves to secure the number two seed, while the Rockets play against the Thunder tomorrow night in Houston.
Yeah. I don't agree with purposely losing. Whether everybody you play in the playoffs is hard. We've said this before. Everybody you play is going to be difficult to play. So whether you play Houston or you play Utah or the Warriors, you're going to have to grind. So losing, going in with that kind of momentum is never a good feeling or anything like that. So, yes, their starters got some rest. That was good. Yes, the second team played very well. Why would you put your third team in? Get the win. So,
Well, I understand it to the point to where you want Houston to slide down to the four seats. That way you don't have to see Houston or Golden State until the Western Conference Finals. But you're hoping that Portland wins out, and you're hoping that Oklahoma City can beat Houston in Houston, which is two very tough things. So for the Nuggets to kind of hold on to trust Portland and trust Oklahoma City to win, you know, it's kind of putting the pressure on them, you know, and then you don't control your own destiny right now to where you have to win these two games. Right, to where if you lose one of them and Houston wins, because we're 3-1 in the season series against Houston, so they own the tiebreaker. So we have to win these two, assuming that Houston is probably going to beat Oklahoma City tomorrow night. And that makes Houston the number three seed, or the number two seed.
Yeah. But there are three teams that the Nuggets will potentially play. It could either be the Thunder, Spurs, or Clippers at this point.
Right, Jokic can't be stopped in a seven game series against them. I'm not saying it's going to be a sweep, but I'm saying that we probably win in 5 or 6 games.
Yeah, good series. I would be scared of the Spurs just because of Pop.
Yeah,
they have so much experience. Yes, the Clippers could be scary when they're on fire. They're young though. Playoff experience is different.
Yeah,
that would be a great series, Clippers Nuggets, just because two inexperienced teams. They're both very good and young. I think it'd be great. But I think that the Spurs are the scariest one. The Thunder are the easiest one. I totally
and the Clippers are right there in the middle. I'm just not afraid of the Clippers, to be honest. To be completely 100% honest. I'm not afraid of the Clippers. I'm not afraid of the Thunder, and I'm really not afraid of the Spurs. It's really you just kind of pick and choose whichever one you're going to beat in the first round, and the first round is going to be breeze, but then all of a sudden the second round you'll potentially see Houston or I guess it depends on how the seeding falls over the next couple days, but it'll be very interesting to see as far as who the Nuggets match up against and the difference between how the Nuggets play in the first round and the second round.
Yeah, it's going to be a battle. I'm excited to watch, and hopefully it's just a bunch of good basketball. That's really all I can hope for, right?
Do you think the Nuggets beat the Jazz or the Timberwolves this week in their last two games to secure the number two seed?
Yeah. If they lose a game, they're going to lose the Timberwolves game.
I disagree.
I don't know.
If we lose a game, I think it's going to be to the Jazz. The Timberwolves have nothing to play for.
Yeah.
The Jazz have a 4-5 seed to battle for. So and plus we never match up well against the Jazz. We've never played well against the Jazz. Granted, we might win or we've won a couple games against them, but I just don't like how the Nuggets match up against them. Rudy Gobert is absolutely a beast when he comes to Denver, plays against Denver or in Utah, and I just think that the Jazz just have a lot of depth that is hard for the Nuggets to keep up with. You know, for as much depth as the Nuggets have, the Jazz have just as much depth.
100%. It's going to be good, man. The playoffs are going to be good this year. Both sides, all even balanced. That bottom two spots in the East is looking really tight. I looked at that, too. So hopefully D-Wade gets in.
I believe it's the last three seeds in the Western Conference are separated by like a half game.
Right.
So both conferences, pretty close.
Super exciting, man. And love this time of the year, April, best time of the year. You got baseball, you got playoff hockey, you got playoff basketball, man. You can't go wrong with that.
But that about wraps up this show. It's very short, under 20 minutes, obviously.
We have a big show coming next week, a super special show, so we're excited for that. We should have a special guest next week.
Yeah, special guest Tucker Reichel coming in next week. He does another radio show and also keeps very involved in MMA and fighting and everything like that.
Yeah.
So we're very, very excited to have him on the show. But his interest in that category of what I just said has nothing to do with the show next week. It's actually completely opposite. So we're excited to get
secret,
into it.
Man. Keep
yeah,
it
we're
a
keeping
secret.
It a secret. And we're excited to get forward. So that's about it. Thank you, Met Radio, for hosting us. Email contact us at game7show@gmail.com. Like us on Facebook at game7show. Follow us on Twitter @_game7, @WillSatler, and @Isaac_Bugarin.
That was impressive. What do we do with the dogs, man?
We always go to the shelter first, man.
Yes, sir. See you guys next week.